Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shooting Iron by William W. Johnstone and J. A. Johnstone. Narrated by A. W. Miller. Chapter 1. Sheriff John Holt helped Deputy Marshal Wheeler haul the prisoner into the prison wagon with the others. The autumn morning sun cast harsh shadows of the thick iron slats cage across the faces of the five prisoners already inside. To Holt, the rattling chains that bound Joe Mullen's hands and feet sang a sad hymn. A month before, Mullen had been the most powerful man in Devil's Gulch, and one of the most important people in the territory. The town had rarely decided on matters of importance without first seeking Mullen's opinion. Now he was nothing more than a common criminal, a man convicted of murdering an outlaw in cold blood. Sheriff Holt might have enjoyed the irony of a killer murdering another killer if it was not also tragic, and despite all the bad blood that had flowed between them, he did not enjoy seeing Mullen in chains. He was always saddened by waste, and Joe Mullen's predicament was a waste. The rancher and mine owner possessed many talents that could have made Devil's Gulch the envy of the territory. Instead of using them for good, he used them to further his own greed. Holt had expected Mullen to put up more of a struggle when the time came to get in the wagon, but he had been as meek as a lamb. He had once been a proud, boisterous man of means and property. He had the town of Devil's Gulch firmly in his grasp. But now he was just another prisoner, crammed beneath a web of iron bars on his way to the Colorado Territorial Prison. Holt remembered Doc Klassen determined that Mullen had suffered a conniption during his incarceration. The prisoner's entire left side had been paralyzed for weeks. He had only regained use of his left leg a week before. As he watched Mullen lower himself to sit on the crowded bench beside two other prisoners, Holt could see his ordeal had robbed him of more than just feeling in his leg or arm. It had robbed him of feeling anything. The heavy iron door squealed as Deputy United States Marshal Dan Wheeler slammed it shut and held it in place while he padlocked it. Holt noticed how small the heavy padlock looked in Wheeler's large hands.
"Didn't expect this one to go in that easy,"
the big deputy marshal said as he walked back to the jail.
"Heard he gave you quite a time when you first brought him in."
Holt took a final look at Mullen before turning to join Wheeler. He had been with Mullen constantly since before his conviction and sentencing the month before. He knew he should have felt some sort of remorse for him, but he did not, except perhaps a bit of sorry at who Joe Mullen might have been.
"He had more fight in him back then," Holt told him. "My neck is still sore from him trying to strangle me. Guess he lost all of the fight in him since." "Conniption's what I heard."
Wheeler nudged Holt with an elbow to the shoulder.
"That's where we differ, John. I'd have killed him if he tried to strangle me."
Holt saw no reason to debate tactics with him. Wheeler was a big man, nearly 5 inches taller than Holt's 6 feet, and much heavier. Most of it was solid, but less of it was with each passing year. He had the look of a man accustomed to getting his way, and Holt was not in the mood to argue.
"I'd rather see him spend the rest of his life in jail." "And that he will, I promise you,"
Wheeler told him.
"He's used to easy living up on that ranch of his. We'll see how he likes standing on a prison chow line eating porridge 3 times a day. I don't think he'll take to it. He'll be dead in a year. 18 months, tops."
But Holt was not so sure. Bitter experience had taught him that anyone who found themselves on the opposite side of Joe Mullen would do well to not sell him short.
"He might not be able to make a run for it, but his mind is sharper than ever. You best not forget that in your travels."
Wheeler stopped outside the jail and took his time in looking over Holt. He did not seem impressed by what he saw.
"That's strange coming from you. I've heard you're no one's idea of a Sunday social either." "You've heard right," Holt told him.
The two lawmen walked into the warmth of the jail, where Holt signed papers granting the federal government custody of Joe Mullen. Holt had made a practice of never telling another lawman what he should do, but he could not let Wheeler ride off without speaking his mind.
"The man down at the livery tells me that your cook wagon is still being repaired."
Wheeler frowned as he folded the papers and tucked them into his vest pocket.
Through Wheel, right before we came into town this morning. The terrain in this part of the territory is hard on horse and haulers alike. The prison wagon is as solid as they come, but that cook wagon is almost as rickety and fickle as the old man I've got driving it. Me and Bob got it back on well enough to bring us here, but it was slower going than I would have liked.
That was the part that bothered Holt. But you're still planning on bringing these men to the territorial prison alone?
The government doesn't pay me to wait around, Wheeler said. They pay me to bring my prisoners in on time and alive. I don't plan on waiting around just because my cook wagon is busted. I have a schedule to keep.
Holt decided it was time to break his rule about advice to lawmen.
I'd strongly advise you to wait for him, Wheeler. The livery says they'll have that wheel fixed in a day or so. Why take chances riding alone over rough terrain with a bunch like this? You're more than welcome to keep your prisoners here in my jail until your cook wagon is ready to go.
Wheeler tucked a cheroot in the corner of his mouth and struck a match alive off Holt's desk to light it.
That's awfully neighborly of you, John, but I have to decline. Waiting here is the sensible thing to do. It's expected, which is why I won't do it.
He waved the flame dead and tossed the match out the door and into the thoroughfare.
If it was just me, might be inclined to do what you say. But it just so happens that I've got a wagon filled with wanton cutthroats, thieves, and nasty individuals of every low human description. Some of them have ridden with some bad people. People who might be looking to break them out if I stay in one place too long. Got a fellow named Hart in there who has some particularly unsavory friends. The sooner I get them locked up behind bars, the sooner I'll be able to rest.
He tossed his thumb toward the doorway.
Don't let those blue skies fool you, Holt. You're new to this territory. You haven't seen how fast the weather can turn ugly out here. We could have a foot of snow tomorrow and ice after that, making the trail impassable. It's already plenty rough as it is. If I delay, I could wind up being forced to stay here all winter.
Holt did not see the problem.
That'd be fine by me. We can always use the extra help, and we'd see to it your prisoners were healthy. I couldn't care less about their well-being. But I do care about my schedule. If I need to winter someplace, I'd rather it be on my own bed at the prison instead of on a cot here in Devil's Gulch.
Wheeler tried a smile as he rubbed his right hip.
You're too young to appreciate this, but I'm not as young as I once was. The years and the miles seem to have piled up on me in the past few months. Guess it's made me lonesome for my comforts. The sooner I get there, the happier I'll be.
Holt was not trying to be difficult, but he decided to put a finer edge on his words.
I might be new to the territory, but I know a thing or two about weather. The snow is still a week or so away. The trip to the prison takes 3 days. You'd fare better on the road with two of you watching the men instead of just you.
But Wheeler was clearly not having any of it.
I've been transporting prisoners from one end of this territory to the other since I was your age. I know how to handle 6 criminals in a cage. 5 and a half, given Mullen's condition.
Holt decided trying to convince Wheeler to delay his trip was useless. He had told the man his concerns, and that would have to be enough. He could not force the issue.
Since you won't listen to reason, how about a word of advice?
The marshal grinned.
Sure, young fella. Just what are you going to tell me that I don't already know about hauling prisoners?
Gag Mullen before you hit the road, Holt told him. His limbs might not work too well at present, but there's nothing wrong with his mouth or his mind. I've seen how convincing he can be when given the chance. He's more than capable of turning those men against you more than they're already inclined to be. You just might find yourself with something of an uprising on your hands before you reach the prison.
Wheeler took the cheroot from his mouth and flicked the ash on the floor. He can talk to them until he's blue in the face. Won't do him any good. Want to know why?
He beckoned Holt to come closer, as if he was about to tell him a secret.
On account of me not giving them a chance to run. See, I don't plan on opening that door again until we reach the prison.
Holt pulled away from Wheeler.
Not even to stretch their legs or tend to their business?
Nope.
Wheeler said.
There's more than enough room in there for them to spread out if they're of a mind to. As for their business, well, that's their problem. If they had wanted to be treated like human beings, they shouldn't have broken the law in the first place. Would have saved themselves, the territory, and me a whole mess and bother if they had. They put themselves in that wagon, Holt. Not me. They'll just have to live with the consequences.
Holt had heard some odd strategies from lawmen in his time, but this one took the prize.
It's liable to get mighty ripe in that wagon. Good thing I plan to keep up a good pace, he said. I like to keep my prisoners lean and hungry with only hardtack and water each morning. Maybe a mouthful of coffee at night if I'm feeling generous. In my experience, a hungry man is easier to bring to heel than a fed one.
A hungry man's also more liable to get desperate and cut your throat, Holt thought. But Wheeler had made it clear that he neither wanted nor needed his advice, so he kept his opinions to himself. Instead, he offered his hand to Wheeler.
Then I wish you the best of luck on your journey, for all of our sake.
The two men shook hands as a man out in the street called out Wheeler's name.
Hold on a minute, Daniel. I need to talk with you.
Wheeler frowned as he stepped outside.
That'll be old Bob, my cook. He's going to take this news worse than you. That old man has been trying to baby me for years.
Holt joined Wheeler on the boardwalk in time to see a man with a long, tangled gray beard who looked to be in dire need of a bath. His skin and clothes bore the dull patina of a lifetime spent on the trail that Holt doubted any amount of scrubbing would remove. He doubted Bob would even try. Men like him never cared much for appearances or money. They lived off the miles they had traveled and the endless stories they produced.
Just hold on right where you are, Daniel,
the cook called out. Three yellowed teeth hung on for dear life at the front of his mouth and caused him to whistle when he spoke. But despite his ragged appearance, the Winchester he toted was spotless and gleamed in the morning sunlight.
I aim to go with you.
Wheeler shook his head.
Not a chance, old-timer. You've got to stay with the wagon until it's fixed. Says so in the regulations.
Them regulations you're so fond of quoting when it suits you say nothing of the kind,
Bob told him.
And that wagon will still be here when we get back in a couple of weeks if the weather holds out.
He held up a canvas bag.
I managed to scrounge up enough supplies for us to make the trip there and back with nary a thought. It won't be biscuits and gravy every morning, but it's a lot better than you just wandering the wilderness by your lonesome.
Wheeler took the sack of supplies from him.
I won't be lonesome. I've got six friendly prisoners to keep me company. And in case you forgot, that cook wagon of yours is federal property. You can't just leave it here unattended. Like I just got through telling the sheriff here. I can handle this on my own. I don't need you.
What you need is a good dose of common sense.
The cook looked at Holt.
Tell it to him again, Sheriff. He won't listen to me any more. Thinks I'm worse than an old washerwoman with all my worrying. Tell him it's just not sensible for a man to ride off alone with a passel of murderers, even if they are bound and chained.
I tried,
Holt said, but he's determined.
Stubborn is what he is.
Bob poked the deputy marshal in the chest with a bony finger.
You've been that way since the day I first laid eyes on you, and you haven't changed a bit. You remind me of an old uncle I had once. You could tell him a storm was coming, but if he was of a mind to stay where he was, he'd just sit there and let the rain soak him to the bone. Never got sick on account of it either, until the day he caught the coughing sickness and died.
Wheeler shut his eyes.
You and your stories.
Bob went on.
You say you're concerned about territorial property? Well, it just so happens that you're territorial property too, Dan. And I'll remind you that busted wagon back there is mine. The territory just pays me for the use of it, and you're more valuable than a pile of pots and provisions. That's why I'm going with you, and I won't take no for an answer.
The old cook decided he had done enough talking as he walked over to the wagon and started to climb up into the box.
"I'll just bring us back to the livery and pick up some of the things I packed. Won't be but a minute."
But Wheeler took a firm hold of Bob's arm and prevented him from going any farther.
"You'll stay with the wagon like I told you. My word is final."
Bob tried to pull away from him, but Holt saw the cook's arm look like a broom handle in Wheeler's massive grip. Bob gradually realized Wheeler would not allow him to come along, and reluctantly stepped away from the wagon.
"This is just plain old-fashioned foolishness, Dan. Blind foolishness, just like my uncle and the coughing sickness, especially after I went through all that trouble of packing up what we'd be needing for the trail."
"Nobody asked you to do that."
Wheeler handed the sack back to him.
"You've got no one to blame but yourself for the wasted effort. You can unpack it just as quickly as you packed it. I've already got everything I need for the trip."
Wheeler was about to flick his cheroot into the thoroughfare, but thought better of it and gave it to Bob instead.
"Here, puff on that a while. It'll make you feel better."
The deputy marshal touched the brim of his hat to Holt before climbing up into the wagon. He might have said the years were creeping up on him, but he was spry for a man of his size.
"So long, Sheriff. Keep an eye on Bob for me. See to it he doesn't get into any trouble. And don't let him have a jug, either. Don't let all that gray hair fool you. He's a handful when he's drinking. Don't let him talk you to death. Just walk away from him when you get bored. He'll hardly notice."
The cook offered a crude response, most of which was drowned out by Wheeler throwing the handbrake and snapping the reins to get the four-horse team rolling out of town and on the road to prison.
"Well, if that don't beat all."
Bob puffed away on the cheroot as he joined Holt in watching Wheeler go.
"That man's still as stubborn as the day I found him. No way to reason with him when he makes his mind up to something. No, sir, not him."
Holt imagined there was a deeper story there, but did not care to hear it. "The livery told me you should be able to hit the road in a day or two. Maybe you'll be able to make up some time and catch him on the trail."
"No, I won't. Not him."
Old Bob inhaled the last of the cheroot and burned his fingers as he spat it out.
"He'll push those horses and those men hard. Got it into his head that we've got some weather coming."
He continued to grumble as Wheeler and the prison wagon rounded the end of Main Street and disappeared.
"Stubborn is what he is. No other word for it. Reminds me of a fella I used to ride with when I used to do some scouting for the army before the war."
Holt was not in the mood for a story and saw no point in continuing their discussion.
"If you need a place to stay, you're more than welcome to sleep in the jail. We don't have any prisoners at present, so it'll probably be quiet. My deputy took off on me, so I'd welcome the company."
Bob cocked a bushy eyebrow at Holt.
"That young fella I heard about, the one who helped you stop Joe Mullen? Jack Turner, wasn't it?"
"Jack Turnbull," Holt corrected him.
No good for a man to walk out on his responsibilities like that, especially a young one. What happened? You two have a fight?"
"That's the problem," Holt admitted. "Everything was fine until one day he was just gone."
The business still troubled him. Holt had arrived at the jail one morning the previous week only to find a note from Jack waiting for him on his desk. The young man's handwriting was nearly impossible to read, but from what Holt could make out, Turnbull claimed to have urgent business to tend to somewhere. Holt could not imagine what business might require a teenaged orphan's attention, and he had not been given the opportunity to ask him. Holt did not like it, but he had no power over the young man, and with Mullen in jail, he could not write after Jack to ask him. But he would be sure to have a long talk with the boy when he came back. If he came back, he reminded himself. Holt decided not to dwell on it.
"You can have the place to yourself most nights if we don't have any customers. Can probably count on sleeping the whole night through. This town's been kind of quiet with Mullen in here. Guess no one was particularly anxious to keep him company. Even the drunks have been behaving themselves."
"Disagreeable sort, was he? Mullen, I mean?"
"Evil sort would be closer to the mark."
Holt stepped aside and gestured Bob to enter the jail.
Feel free to look the place over first if you want, see if it meets your approval.
No need for such formalities, Sheriff.
Bob glanced inside the jail.
It's got four walls, a floor, and bars, just like every other jail I've been to. I'm sure it'll suit me just fine. I've slept in worse places.
The cook picked up his bag and waddled under the heavy load into the jail.
Like the time I was taken hostage by a band of Comanche renegades. Don't know if you've ever come across their like, Sheriff, but they're not known for their hospitality.
Holt might have been able to do without a story for every topic, but he was glad Bob had taken him up on his offer. Before coming to Devil's Gulch, Holt had always preferred to work alone. One less person to trust meant one less person to disappoint him. But young Jack Turnbull had managed to change his opinion on the matter. He had just begun to grow accustomed to having him around when he took off. He was not so much hurt as disappointed. He thought Jack held more regard for him, despite the fact they had met while he took him into custody.
"Make yourself at home,"
Holt said as he walked inside and took his rifle down from the rack on the wall.
"It's about time for me to walk the town anyway. I'll do my best to be quiet when I get back in case you're sleeping."
"Be as loud as you like, Sheriff."
Old Bob tested the mattress for firmness.
"I've never been one to sleep once the sun comes up anyway, but if you do, you won't be able to wake me. Always sleep like a baby indoors. Guess that's on account of it not happening too often. I spend most of my time out on the trail with Wheeler, hauling criminals across creation. The stories I could tell you would make that dark hair of yours turn white. Why, there was one time I found myself in Golden City right after."
Holt stepped out onto the boardwalk and pulled the door shut behind him. Bob was clearly a man who liked to talk. He was probably brimming with stories of men he'd known in his time. Places he had been, outlaws he had killed. He imagined Wheeler featured prominently in most of them. But John Holt had never been much of one for conversation. He always preferred to let his actions and his guns do his talking for him. And although he had only been in Devil's Gulch for a little more than a month, his guns had already said quite a bit. The sheriff took his time as he began the long walk along Main Street. Joe Mullen might be on his way to prison, but there was still plenty of trouble to be had if a man went looking for it, and the people of Devil's Gulch were paying quite a sum to seek it out. He walked the boardwalks at least once a day at different times. It paid to let the people know he was around and keeping an eye on things. His first few days as sheriff had resulted in quite a bit of violence, more than Holt preferred. But the mood in town had calmed to a low boil in the weeks since Devil's Gulch had lost their mayor to one of Mullen's assassins, and several citizens who had foolishly dared to test Holt's mettle. He intended on keeping it that way. When he had first come to town, several weeks before, Holt learned the Blue Bottle Saloon was the center of political life in Devil's Gulch. That first day he had found Mayor Blair Chapman, Dr. Ralph Klassen, Joe Mullen, and Tony Cassidy in the middle of breakfast, discussing town business over plates of runny eggs and burnt bacon. The town had changed since then. Mullen was being carted off to jail. Mayor Chapman had been killed and replaced in office by his widow. Doc Klassen took his breakfast at Jean Roche's cafe. The bottle, as it was known, had lost its shine for the town's leading citizens. But Holt knew that while Cassidy might not have had the influence he once enjoyed, he was far from docile or defenseless. The recent downturn in his fortunes had made him desperate to hold on to whatever power he had. Holt knew desperate men were often the most dangerous, which was why he had decided to make the bottle his first visit following Mullen's departure. Cassidy and his customers needed to be reminded they no longer ran Devil's Gulch. That honor now belonged to Sheriff John Holt. The strength with which he delivered that lesson would depend entirely on them. Chapter 2. Holt pushed in the door to the Blue Bottle Saloon and found Tony Cassidy at his usual spot, perched at the far end of the bar, facing the door. He was slouched over a mug of coffee. He was too thin for his frame, and his deep, sunken eyes made it appear that he had not slept in more than a week. One might be forgiven for thinking Cassidy was sick,
But Holt knew better. He always looked like that, and he was all too capable for Holt's tastes. His reddened eyes were lifeless when they fell on Holt as the sheriff approached him. Cassidy used to be sharp-tongued and always good for an insult, but on that morning he looked ready to climb into bed and pull the blanket over his head.
"What do you want, Holt?"
Cassidy sneered as Holt stopped 10 feet away.
"Did you come here to gloat? Because if you have, you might as well turn around and be on your way. I'm in no mood today."
Holt had no intention of gloating, but he would not be run off by the saloonkeeper either.
"I wanted to make sure you knew that Mullen is on his way to prison. The marshal just took him away a few minutes ago. I figured you should hear it from me, personally."
Cassidy slid the coffee mug away from him.
"What do you expect me to do about it? Throw myself on the floor, prostrate in grief? Give you an apology for all I've done or all that you think I've done?"
Holt shook his head. "Wouldn't make much of a difference if you did."
"Do you want me to go for my gun? Maybe get even for my poor friend Joe?"
Cassidy stepped away from the bar and held his arms away from his sides.
"Well, too bad for you I ain't armed."
"I wouldn't care if you were," Holt smiled. "You'd never get the chance to pull it."
Cassidy went back to the bar and picked up his mug.
"Sorry to disappoint you, Sheriff. Guess I'm fresh out of feelings for the moment."
"Fresh out of friends, too. At least the type that you don't have to pay to be in your company."
Cassidy sneered at the insult to his profession. "Men are always going to find a way to entertain themselves, Holt. If I don't sell it to them, someone else will. That goes all the way back to the Bible. You'd have figured that out for yourself if you'd ever bothered to learn how to read."
"I can read just fine," Holt said. "I can read the Bible. I can read men, too. Want me to tell you why you're still alive?"
"No, but I have a feeling you're going to tell me anyway."
Holt did.
"On account of you being smart, or at least smart enough to never push me directly. You're not just a flesh peddler, but an instigator. You'd had a hand in everything that's gone wrong and gotten people killed in this town long before I came along. You were all too happy to just plant seeds in Mullen's mind and watch him throw his weight around for your benefit. Now, he's gone, and you and I are the only two left that matter. If you keep on being smart, you'll have no trouble from me. But if you or any of your friends try to be smarter than you are, I'll see to it that you spend the rest of your miserable life in the cell next to Mullen." "I don't need friends," the saloon owner said. "All I need are customers, and I've got plenty of those, despite what you or Ma McAdam or the Chapman widow try to do to me. So, until I either break the law or cross you, I don't expect to see you in here much, and you sure won't be seeing me."
Cassidy sipped his coffee and placed the mug on the bar.
"I heard you out, and you've heard me. If there's nothing else, I'd appreciate it if you turned around and went about your business. If I never see you again, it'll be too soon."
But Holt did not move.
"You'll be seeing plenty of me if you ever stick your head out of the hole again. You'd best remember what I told you when your pride starts gnawing at you late at night."
Holt noticed Cassidy hesitate before he brought the mug to his lips again. He expected the saloon owner to try to have the last word, but was surprised when he simply drank his coffee in silence. Holt slowly backed out of the bar. As he resumed his walk around town, he wondered if Cassidy really was as beaten as he seemed. He doubted it. Men like that were never out of a fight unless they were dead. He was cooking something else, and whenever he decided to serve it, John Holt would be more than ready. Cassidy kept his eyes on Holt as he backed out of his saloon. He hated everything about the man, the way he walked, the way he spoke to him, how he thought he was better than anyone else in town, how he was every bit as dangerous as he thought he was. No amount of disdain he had for the sheriff would ever cause him to take him lightly. But John Holt was not perfect, and he was nowhere near as clever as he believed himself to be. Tony Cassidy had never been good with a gun or a rifle. He was even more inept with his fists. He only considered himself fair with a knife, but he took solace in the fact that he had killed every man he had ever marked for death. He learned from an early age that his talents were elsewhere. There were other ways to impose his will on his enemies. One of them was through influence. He gained influence by listening to them. As a saloon owner, there was always someone willing to share their troubles. He knew if you fed a man enough whiskey or beer, he would bare his soul to you, his hopes and dreams, his greatest fears and darkest secrets. Tony knew men would tell him all about themselves by what they said and did not say under the power of liquor. And men always found a willing audience in Tony, who often swept up the hidden parts of themselves only to store them away for a time when it might benefit them. Having spent most of his life in saloons, either as a bartender or an owner, Cassidy had spent many years honing his craft to perfection. Lately he had used his stark gift, and he did consider it a gift, on Joe Mullen. The boisterous rancher was more than willing to play the fool for him in the belief he was serving himself while furthering Cassidy's hidden aims. Mullen craved adoration and notoriety. Cassidy was content to let him believe he took the lead. All Cassidy wanted was control. John Holt's arrival in Devil's Gulch had changed everything, and once Mayor Chapman had been killed, it became clear to Cassidy that Mullen could not resist the chance to go against the new sheriff. That left Cassidy with little choice than to put another plan in motion. A plan that would remove Mullen permanently for the safety of Cassidy's influence. The first part of his plan had gone well. Joe Mullen was disgraced and bound for prison where he would spend the rest of his life behind bars. Now that he was gone forever, it was time for Cassidy to begin the next phase of his scheme, a plan that would be far more subtle than Joseph Mullen could ever be. And if it worked according to plan, John Holt would be spending the winter somewhere far away. From behind him, Cassidy heard his bartender, a brute named Simpson, clear his throat to gain his attention. At least the big oaf had been smart enough to duck out the back door of the saloon when he saw Holt out on the boardwalk and remain hidden until the sheriff left. But now that he was gone, Simpson had returned bearing a message. Cassidy turned to look at him. "You can come out now. The bad man is gone." The bartender lumbered into the saloon and kept his voice low as he said,
"Got that package you wanted me to fetch for you, Tony. It's in your office."
Cassidy doubted Doc Klassen would ever ask the bartender to assist him in a delicate surgery, but he was more than capable of carrying out simple tasks laid out for him, such as bringing someone to the bottle.
"Good man." Cassidy picked up his mug of coffee and walked back toward his office.
"Send the rest of the pot in when you have a chance, Bob, and see to it that no one disturbs us, not even Holt."
"Pot's already in there waiting for you," Simpson told him. "And don't worry, Holt won't be showing his face in here today."
Cassidy hoped the simpleton was proven right. For all he knew, he might be. For even a broken clock was right twice a day.
Chapter 3. After pleasantries were exchanged, Sarah Bell Mullen folded her gloved hands on her lap.
"So good of you to come by," Cassidy gushed as he sat behind his desk. "Although I wouldn't have blamed you if you put it off for a day or so. I'm sure today has been very trying for you."
"What makes today so special?"
"Because the Federals were here in town. They carted Joe off to jail less than half an hour ago, by my reckoning."
Sarah Bell's expression remained flat.
"Why would I care about that? We sprung our trap on that scoundrel weeks ago. Carting him off to jail just seals it, is all."
Cassidy laughed.
"You're nothing if not practical, Sarah Bell."
There was hardly a man in town who did not admire her beauty. Not even Cassidy was immune. She had a graceful elegance about her. She was tall and thin with golden hair and clear blue eyes. it would be easy to dismiss her as a pretty face and nothing more. But no amount of fine clothes or manners could conceal her true nature from Cassidy's discerning eye. He knew she was a frontier woman to her core. When it became clear to Cassidy that Holt was a bone that Joe would never bury, the saloon owner focused his attentions to Mrs. Mullen. She had been unwilling to betray her husband at first, which was to be expected. They had been married for almost 10 years by then, and although their union had failed to produce children, there was a certain allegiance present. An allegiance Cassidy watched die when he told her of the many times her husband had been unfaithful to her in the upstairs rooms of the Blue Bottle Saloon. At the time, he could tell that she had been aware of her husband's dalliances, but being confronted with them by a relative stranger was something altogether different. Cassidy remembered standing in the front parlor of the home that she and Mullen had built together when he told her the news. He allowed her to rage at him, at least for a time, before he slowly introduced his plan. A plan that would not only remove Mullen as a liability, but offer Sarabelle the vengeance she wanted and deserved. To Cassidy's benefit, of course. Since having convinced her to testify against her husband in open court, Cassidy wondered if her conscience might have gotten the better of her. He could tell by her blank expression at the news of her husband being carted off to jail that she felt no guilt for her actions. Good.
"Since you don't appear to be in mourning," Cassidy said, "maybe we should skip the coffee and drink something stronger to toast our new partnership."
"Not until I know what our partnership is, Mr. Cassidy." The saloon owner waved off the formality.
"Call me Tony, please. It's the least you can do after all we've been through together."
"You mean after we betrayed my husband," she said, putting a finer point on it. Cassidy decided the conversation might not be cause for a celebration just yet.
"After he betrayed both of us first. He betrayed you upstairs and he betrayed me out there. On the boardwalk, when he could not see past his blind hatred for Holt. All we did was solve a problem that plagued both of us."
When she listed her head to the side, Cassidy decided he did not like the way she was looking at him. He felt like something being studied as opposed to someone she was speaking with.
"You're a strange man, Tony. You never go after something straight on, do you? You like to come at it when it's not looking, or maybe even from behind it."
"A deliberate nature takes many forms," Cassidy said. "The way a man goes about something doesn't matter as long as that something gets done."
"Or a woman."
He gladly conceded the point.
"In this case, yes, which was why I was looking forward to our conversation today. Your husband and I were very successful in business together."
She offered a hint of a smile.
"Behind every successful man, there's a strong woman, Tony. You'd know that if you'd ever decided to take a wife of your own."
"Why, Sarabelle," he picked up his coffee mug. "I could be forgiven for taking that as a proposal of marriage."
Her smile soured.
"Don't flatter yourself. The only arrangement I want with you is a formal one. I don't even like the idea of shaking hands with you, much less the notion of taking you as a husband."
"We agree on that much," Cassidy laughed as he drank his coffee. "I don't sleep well with one eye open, and that's how I'd have to sleep with you around."
"I think we make a formidable team in our own way," she said. "We succeeded in ridding ourselves of Joe, and I see no reason we can't work together in the future, provided we come to some kind of an arrangement."
It was music to his ears, but he kept his enthusiasm to himself.
"I'm not sure we need an agreement," Cassidy set his mug on his desk. "I liked working with Joe, sure. We had a good thing going until he went and started thinking he was better than he really was. I'll admit, my take has suffered some, but I'm still making good money on my own."
"You sound quite content."
"That's because I am."
She slowly shook her head.
"No, you're not. You've never drawn a content breath in your life. You do what you do because it is your nature. Same as me."
Cassidy shifted in the chair. He was not used to being spoken to this way, and he had never had such a frank conversation with a woman before.
"Sounds nice, but it doesn't tell me what's on your mind."
"My husband is on his way to spend the rest of his life in prison," she began. "And we both know he's never coming back. The empire we built together remains. I'll make sure all my men know that the blue bottle is the preferred place for them to drink while they're in town. Some will disobey me, as is their nature, but we'll do our best to keep them out of the railhead. I know Ma McAdam and Frank Peters are your enemies. Cassidy did his best to hide his displeasure. That's a nice sentiment, Sarabelle, but regular customers from your mines and ranches were never the biggest part of the arrangement I had with Joe. She drew in a deep breath and looked up at the ceiling. I'm quite aware that you and Joe had this town carved up between the two of you before John Holt darkened our door. We have that idiot Mayor Chapman to thank for bringing Holt here. The best thing that fool ever did was get himself killed. Cassidy smiled. Not a very good idea to speak ill of the dead, is it? And we need good ideas right now, you and I. She tilted her head as she looked him over. What about you, Tony? You're the one who invited me here today. What did you want to talk about? A mutual problem. With the mayor's widow taking up his duties, you and I are in a poor position. I don't see why. Mrs. Chapman and I aren't exactly cordial, but I fail to see how she can harm my interests. She thinks Joe and I put up that miner to shoot her husband, Cassidy explained. She knows the assassin was in here drinking his fill before he got it into his head to shoot the mayor. She blames me and Joe for it, and that means she blames you in Joe's absence. She can hardly touch you now, but if you start expanding, she can find ways to make your life difficult if she chooses. Elizabeth Chapman isn't a nice woman, but she's smarter than her husband ever was. Her eyes narrowed. Has she shown Ma McAdam's railhead saloon any consideration? Cassidy shook his head. She doesn't like saloons much, even though drinking is the biggest business in town. Well, when you add together all the saloons, anyway. And how many do you personally control, Tony? Cassidy began to have a new appreciation for her cunning. He wondered how much Joe had told her about their association over the years and how much he had kept from her. I own the bottle outright. Helped the rest of them get started by loaning them money before the bank opened here. I have small interests in the other saloons in town except for the railhead. The interest they pay me isn't enough to live on, but I've got some say over how they run things. Why? Think you could take them over one by one? He was beginning to see what she was getting at. None of them are close to paying off what they owe me, so I suppose you could say that I own them now. Why? He watched Sarabelle adjust her gloves as she appeared to give the matter some thought. Since saloons are the most popular businesses in town, sounds like we'd have a chance to help or hurt any cause we care about. Maybe it's time we work on undermining Mrs. Chapman and put someone we trust in her chair. Someone who's more of a friend to us. Cassidy had done something similar with Blair Chapman's candidacy. The friendly haberdasher had never even thought of becoming a politician until Cassidy and Mullen managed to talk him into it. The two men had used their combined influence to gain support from the town's drinking citizens, and he was elected to office unopposed. He had done whatever Mullen and Cassidy had told him to do. He had turned a blind eye to the rash of crimes that benefited Mullen and Cassidy. Without a sheriff, Mullen's vigilance committee enforced law, which only solidified their hold over the town. Which was why Chapman's decision to bring John Holt to town had taken them by surprise and, ultimately, destroyed their plans. Cassidy liked the way Sarabelle Mullen thought. It was not only a good idea that had worked before, it would probably work again. The election isn't until next year. We can't pin our hopes on a bunch of drunks remaining loyal to us for that long. Why, in a few months people will think she's been in office for years. Which is why we must act immediately, she said. Joe and I still have many friends in the capital, Sarabelle said. None of them had wanted to risk helping Joe during his murder trial, of course. That's to be expected, especially from a politician. But me, she smiled. I'm as much of a victim of his shortcomings as anyone, perhaps even more. They may not like my husband, but they like our money. I'm sure I can talk them into supporting a special election here in Devil's Gulch. Especially since Elizabeth seized her husband's office without giving the citizens a say in her decision. Cassidy had always thought he had more influence with Sarabelle and Joe than he let on. His wife had just said as much. How quickly do you think you could get them to do that? I won't know for certain until I ask, but I can send a telegram today before I leave town. They'll probably be relieved when they realize I'm not begging them to help Joe.
The more he thought about the idea, the more he liked it.
Having an election is one thing. Picking the right man to run is something different.
She did not seem to mind the closeness between them, nor his hand on hers. I was counting on you to pick a suitable candidate, Tony. Your share of the burden of our partnership.
Cassidy laughed again, only this time there was no trace of humor in it.
Our partnership. I like the sound of that. Joe and I might have worked together, but we were hardly partners. He had the income from his ranches and his mines. All I ever got was the business from the bottle and what I used to make from providing protection through the Vigilance Committee. Now that the committee is no more, I don't make nearly as much as you think.
He was glad to see the stone facade of her expression fade a bit. She had not considered a downturn in his fortunes once change had come to Devil's Gulch. It also had the virtue of being true.
When you put it that way, she said, perhaps I was wrong to think there was a way we might be able to work together. It seems like your prospects have diminished a great deal since Joe's conviction. Perhaps you're not as valuable to me as I had hoped.
Cassidy held up a hand in slight protest.
Don't try flattery so early in the negotiations, Sarabelle. It weakens your advantage.
And I sense I am wasting my time. She began to rise from her chair. Good day to you, Tony.
Wait! Cassidy barked louder than he had intended. He had not counted on her calling his bluff. He could not allow her to leave, for it would cost him twice as much to get her back to the bargaining table later.
If you walk out that door, you'll be making a big mistake.
I have a feeling the mistake will be just as big if I stay here.
Not so.
Cassidy could tell the time for subtlety had passed.
You've become a woman of considerable wealth. You've got a thriving ranch and several mines that show no sign of being played out for the next few years, maybe even longer.
Sarabelle remained seated.
Joe told you quite a bit, didn't he?
Cassidy did not see the point in telling her that. When it came to drinking, Joe was a lightweight. Some men wept when drunk. Some sought out a fight. Joe became talkative and grew eager to prove he was far more powerful than he already appeared to be. He had always found a willing audience in Tony Cassidy.
If you set aside our mutual faults, Joe and I were friends, and we helped each other, just like I'm willing to help you now.
Other than removing the Chapman widow from office, it sounds like I don't need any help from you or anyone else.
True, but the fact that you agreed to come see me at all proves you're after more than just money, Cassidy said. If all you wanted was wealth and riches, you never have to lift a finger for the rest of your life. All you have to do is tolerate a visit from your husband's business managers a few times a year to sign documents and spend the rest of your life counting your money.
You're not doing a very good job of convincing me that I need you, Tony.
I didn't think I'd have to. You're a clever woman. Ruthless, too.
Now you're insulting me.
But Joe never allowed you to know much about his affairs, which means you don't know the first thing about business. That's not to say you can't learn, but such lessons can prove expensive. Lawyers and business managers may try to take advantage of your inexperience. Not at first, of course. Any theft would happen slowly over time, but eventually it will happen and you know it. Before long, you'll be at their mercy, and after they think they've stolen enough from you, they'll attempt to buy you out or force you out at a mere fraction of what your holdings are worth. They'll leave you the ranch, but that won't be enough for you.
Her eyebrows rose. What makes you think so?
Because if it was, you wouldn't have bothered coming here today. You wouldn't be interested in getting your own man elected mayor. You need me and you...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.